I'm Carmel Pratt with Reimagine Buildings. You're watching Massive Passive.
What comes to mind when you picture the buildings in Massachusetts? Do you picture revolution-era buildings like Paul Revere's house? Maybe you think of the stately government buildings that have landmarked Boston's history. Cutting-edge and ultra-high-performing buildings are probably not the first thing that come to mind when you think of the New England state. But that is all about to change in a massive way. Massachusetts has just become a global leader in building energy policy, with Passive House becoming code in much of the state. Today, we join architect Michelle Apigian on site for a tour of the Finch Cambridge Affordable Housing Project, which helped spark this low-energy building movement. Hear from Michelle how Passive House is a perfect fit for affordable housing and a great way to reinvigorate the building industry.
Let's see how this building became the largest new construction affordable housing project to bring 100% permanent affordable housing to Cambridge in the last 40 years, all while achieving the Passive House standard.
So it's 98 units of affordable family housing. So there are a lot of two bedrooms and a good deal of three bedrooms in this building, which I mentioned because you know that density matters. And so there are a lot of big units and there are a lot of kids in this building. It is six stories over a open air garage. All the residential units are uplifted well out of the 2070 floodplain, as is the lobby, but just barely at the lobby. And of course, accessibility is important. And on the top floor, which we'll go check out, there is a pretty extensive amount of community space. And we located it on the top floor where everyone would have the benefit of the view of Fresh Pond. So even the laundry is right there. So if someone's doing laundry and someone wants to be studying in the community space or one of the study nooks, you know, everyone kind of can benefit from that rather than the three units that happen to face the pond. We've also got a 105 kW PV array on the roof, which offsets, we think, and obviously time will tell more, 20 to 25% of the load. All the systems are central. So we've got central ERP for the whole building with a couple of unique ones in the spaces that are outside the envelope. Central heating and cooling with VRF heat pump and fewer condensers, which allows for that big array on the roof. And then gas for central hot water, which is the nut that we keep trying to crack and we keep testing on lots of projects.
Passive House is really just a
perfect fit for affordable housing. Number one, they're long-term owners, generally speaking. So the energy usage of the building and the implications on has a direct impact on their bottom line. So if the building is using less energy, the owner is spending less energy every month, every year. It's also all these nonprofits are mission driven. They want to have high quality places for people to build their lives and be safe and comfortable. And so, you know, having not only is it low energy, but it's these buildings are so comfortable. They're not drafty. They're quiet. It's amazing what happens when you open a window and you face out on the major street and you realize how much noise there really is out there, but you don't hear that. This is our kind of amenity floor. Jane, the owner, was delighted to think about kind of co-locating all this stuff and making it really more of a hub for the building. So this room is intended to be sort of a more low-key thing. Folks could sit, you know, and just bring their laptops in here, relax, obviously have the study nooks. These, I understand, have been heavily used, especially through COVID when everyone was schooling from home and working from home and they sign up for a time slot. And then in here, we've got a kitchen and kind of a larger space, which is intended to really allow for, you know, events for folks in the building, but also folks to come in and learn about cooking, teach about cooking, use the roof deck to, you know, grow some vegetables, grow some herbs, and really kind of the idea is that you could throw the doors open and this could become a whole educational space and also help people eat better and save money. See, we've got tomatoes, basil. Awesome. So you can actually almost see in the winter, you can fully see the reservoir because these trees are almost all deciduous. Although these doors are not passive house level doors. All the glazing is still triple glazed, and we didn't modify the exterior wall assembly in any way, just because it was in or out. That's continuous. This project was HRI issued an RFP, and so we were one of several to respond to it, and we pitched the passive house approach to them, saying whether or not you want to certify, we would love to bring that mindset to the table. And initially, actually, Jane was not prepared to certify, just the added costs, the added concerns around what happens if you don't succeed, you know, all of that. So, again, the Mass CEC incentives came into play. We applied, even though we were under construction, we applied for the incentives and we were awarded them, but we couldn't take advantage of the full 4,000 because we were already under construction. So I think Jane was able to get half of them maybe. And that kind of made it work. And then we sort of said, okay, now we need real energy modeling, not just our initial feasibility stuff. We got the team together and everyone just kind of rolled with it. And I kept waiting for the pricing to come back saying, you're going to have to shave something here. But it never got there. We just started with what we thought we needed and wanted, and we never had to get rid of it. There's a lot that's going on in this building that has nothing to do with passive house and a lot to do with other goals like general wellness, biophilic design. It's also Fitwell certified. It's also Enterprise Green certified. A lot of broader goals. This is a pretty typical one bedroom. One of the key things that we have learned to do is to put our fan coil closet abutting the bedroom and the living room so that it can intake on the face and deliver on the face and deliver also into the bedroom. So you do not have to go up into the rated assembly. So obviously, when you get to a two-bedroom or a three-bedroom, then you have to duct. You've got to get up into the assembly to get over. But at least you're saving a little bit. As is so often the case, right? We've got a stair coming down to the garage. We've got to have a clear drive lane. We can't swing out. We don't have room for a vestibule. Like, just goes on and on. So this angle, and you can kind of read it all the way up. Underneath that is, I think, 4 inches of rigid insulation, or mineral wool, rather. And the stairs are CMU, so there's also 4 inches outside. And, of course, the air barrier. And here, these are the types of places where, though we try to avoid spray foam, can come in really handy when you needed to be continuous and there's no great plane or way to get a clean surface to attach to. Yeah. We did a lot of analysis of the dew point and ultimately evaluated that if we oversprayed a certain number of feet in either direction around the column, that it got just enough so that we didn't have a risk of condensation on the floor inside. But it was an analysis during construction that we wish we hadn't had to do. And now our structural engineers know. They'll be like, isn't that a thermal break? Do we need? Yes, it is. Yes, we do. So we're all learning. The passive house movement is reinvigorating the construction industry. So I think the architecture side of the equation, we've been getting on board. I can't imagine many big firms in Boston at this point that aren't paying attention to passive house. I think it's highly improbable. And that's probably true in many places all over the country. The builders don't have the experience and they're the ones pricing it. And so having the building industry itself really understand how to price it and what it is important. SCEC is certainly pushing for more trades training in general. How do we help bring folks up to speed, and how do we do that in a way that actually helps address equity issues too, bringing more diversity into the trades, helping people understand how to be part of the future green economy, the current green economy, not, you know, some legacy mindset about installing gas all over the place. So we're seeing really cool programs, Roxbury Community College and other places that are all working on this issue. And I think when people feel valued, they'll do a better job, and then they don't see the construction industry as a dead end, right? They see it as a real opportunity.